On this week's show, Tesla takes a parts supplier to court, Honda announces pricing information for the Clarity FCV in the US, and GM launches a brand new mobility service. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolved.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, January 22nd, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and I'd just like to thank those of you who helped us roll past our second Patreon goal this week. Woohoo! You all rock. Celebration aside, there's plenty of news to cover this week, so onwards and upwards to our first story, courtesy of Tesla's Model X all-electric SUV, and at least one of the reasons behind why it was delayed several times on its journey to production. For as long as we can remember, those magical second-row Falcon wing doors were blamed for at least some of the delays to the Model X, with sources inside Tesla claiming the company just couldn't tie down the quality control for the complicated double-hinged doors. Now it turns out that that delay was down to a third-party parts supplier from Germany, or at least that's what Tesla alleges in papers filed with the US federal courts this week. According to Tesla, the parts supplier won its contract to produce the hydraulic lifting mechanism for the Model X Falcon Wing doors, but after more than a year of trying, it just couldn't build reliable working prototypes. With production massively delayed, Tesla found an alternative electromechanical solution via a new parts supplier, cut ties with the original firm, and finally began Model X production last fall. Since then, however, the original parts supplier has been chasing Tesla for the money it claims the company owes it, while Tesla says its decision to pick a different supplier for production does not breach a single contract. To defend itself, Tesla filed court papers this week preventing the supplier in question from continuing its claim for money, but right now it's not clear what the outcome of this particular case will be, or indeed if either party are in breach of their contracts. Talking of contractual obligations, however, we brought you the rumour on Tuesday that General Motors and Honda, who have been working on hydrogen fuel cell technology together for many years, have inked a new agreement to build a brand new production facility, specifically to mass produce affordable hydrogen fuel cell stacks. Traditionally, the most expensive part by far of a hydrogen fuel cell electric vehicle, current fuel cells work out to around $50,000 per car. So the rumored new production facility, due to be built by 2018, would be tasked with using economies of scale to bring down the cost of hydrogen fuel cell technology. At the moment, while Honda has just launched its Clarity FCV, and we've more news on that later on in today's show, GM doesn't have a production hydrogen fuel cell vehicle on the market yet, but it has been working on fuel cell technology now for more than a decade, at least at an experimental level. And this news does suggest a production FCV from the Detroit automaker isn't that far away. Staying with GM for a second, the automaker launched a brand new mobility platform on Wednesday this week, called Maven, which it hopes will keep the company relevant and forward-thinking in a world where car ownership is slowly being replaced by car sharing and ride sharing apps. Due to launch first in Ann Arbor, Michigan, Maven utilizes the always-on internet connection of GM's latest cars like the 2016 Chevrolet Volt and the upcoming 2017 Chevrolet Bolt to make it possible for individuals to rent out their cars via a peer-to-peer sharing service and for individuals to arrange ride-sharing with owners of Maven-enabled cars, as well as finding an easy way for people to find and cross large campuses or city centers when they're visiting with a hired car. At the heart of the new system is a smartphone app, which will enable users to find and book available cars and lifts in their neighborhood. Like other car sharing platforms, reserved cars can be unlocked from the smartphone app. But what makes Maven particularly cool is the way in which it customizes the car you're borrowing to make sure it feels like your own. Radio and address books are automatically synced for the duration of the ride, as well as seat positions and other personal tweaks to help make the car that you're renting feel like one you've owned for a while. It's all pretty neat. Talking of neat things, BMW continued its attempts to connect the world to its cars this week, with the news that connected drive customers can now integrate their BMW i3 and BMW i8 with If This, Then That, an Internet of Things service that serves to connect disparate services in one simple, action-based scripting language. Just like the tie-up between BMW and SmartThings we told you about last week, this new IFTTT integration relies on you connecting your BMW connected drive account to the service and agreeing to allow integration between it and your car. Once set up, however, the service, currently in beta at bmwlabs.com, can be used to script any number of different behaviours depending on where you or your car is. You could, for example, set the kettle to brew when you're just a few miles from home, or perhaps you could let your kids know when you're about to pick them up from school. I know it's not for everyone, but if you are a BMW i3 or i8 owner and you do like your gadgets, head over to our site for more information. One thing we wish we had a little more information on right now is the ongoing Dieselgate scandal, which claimed two new victims this week in the form of Renault and Opel. As we reported on Tuesday, both General Motors European arm Opel and French automaker Renault are quietly carrying out recall programs to improve the tailpipe CO2 and nitrogen oxides emission of certain diesel-powered vehicles. While GM's recall program to the Opel/Vauxhall Zafira Tourer MPV is supposed to be to bring the diesel-powered variants in line with European emissions regulations, models have actually been recorded emitting more than five times the legal limit, GM isn't publicly admitting to any foul play. Renault, meanwhile, is carrying out a voluntary recall to certain 110 horsepower diesel variants of its Captur crossover after an in-exhaust filtration system was found not to be functioning correctly. Unlike GM, whose recall is software-based, Renault's fix is to replace the faulty components with ones that operate in the temperature range normal for Europe, reducing tailpipe emissions and hopefully fixing that non-compliance issue. A car that definitely doesn't have to worry about tailpipe emissions, however, is the Nissan Leaf and its electrically powered sibling, the ENV200 electric minivan. While Nissan has historically used in-house battery packs manufactured in a joint partnership between it and Japanese electronics company NEC to power both vehicles to date, there's been some question recently as to if it would continue to do so for the next generation Nissan Leaf. But on Thursday this week, Nissan confirmed that its battery production facilities would begin making the fourth generation battery packs that we presume, but Nissan hasn't confirmed, will pack an impressive 60 kilowatt hours of capacity into the same space as Nissan's current 30 kilowatt hour battery packs. At the Sunderland plant in England, where European Leafs are manufactured, the commitment to producing the next generation cells in-house is worth an estimated £26.5 million sterling, and it will help safeguard more than 300 jobs at the specialised battery production facility. Switching gears now, we're jumping all the way from the UK to North America, where Honda officially launched plans this week for its 2017 Honda Clarity FCV. Expected to launch in California before the end of this year, Honda said the Clarity fuel cell sedan, which features seating for five versus the four accommodated in its rival, the Toyota Mirai FCV, will be available in select California markets for a monthly lease of $500 per month as of the end of the year. That, as we and other sites have noted, is exactly the same figure that you can lease a Hyundai Tucson FCV or Toyota arrive if you happen to live in one of those few areas where they're sold. Initially, cars will be for lease only, but eventually Honda says it does plan to sell the Clarity for a total price of around $60,000, a few thousand dollars more, we note, than the Mirai's current list price. Unlike Toyota, however, which rushed the Mirai to market before the fueling infrastructure was ready, it looks as if Honda is playing it safe, waiting until the end of the year to give hydrogen infrastructure a chance to catch up before it pushes the Clarity to market. Even then, however, we'd expect the Clarity to be something of a niche market car, definitely not a mainstream model for everyone. And to finish today's show, here's a car which is most definitely not mainstream. In fact, it's so special, there's only one of them in the world. I'm talking about the custom-built all-electric T.E.N class rally car that's competed in this year's Dakar rally. Built by Spanish conglomerate Acciona, this go-anywhere EV competed in last year's Dakar rally, but pulled out after just three stages with a navigation fault. Following its successful completion of the 2015 All-Libya World Rally, however, its 2016 Dakar attempt was far more impressive. Sadly, the car and its 150 kilowatt hour lithium ion battery pack was forced to pull out just 2 days before the end of the 12-day event due to a failure to arrive at the starting gate on day 11 on time. But considering more than half of the competitors who enter Dakar every year fail to finish, we think this team did amazingly well as to get as far as they did, only to be scuppered by a lack of time to charge overnight due to a late arrival the previous night. Congratulations to the team, and here's to seeing you compete in Dakar again in 2017. Sadly, all my competitive spirit has upped and left me this week, but I still have plenty of things lined up for the coming week, so I hope that that will do. As always, you'll find all the news that's fit to print at our website at transportevolved.com. Catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolved, or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please consider keeping us independent and impartial by visiting our Patreon page at patreon.com/transportevolved, or clicking on the link and pledging your support from as little as $1 per month. As I said at the top of the show, we've now reached our second goal, but for me to continue doing this as my only job, we need to break our third goal pretty soon, or I have to find another gig. So if you can, it'd be great if you could help out. As always, there's a lot we haven't managed to fit into today's show, including news of the factory where Audi's first long-range electric SUV will be made, Nissan celebrates 3 million cumulative all-electric miles across its UK taxi fleets, an autonomous car crashes in San Francisco, and we ponder if range per charge or charging infrastructure is more important for the average electric car owner. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend, and until next time, keep evolving.